over some of the tape you had, and you were in the Navy or boxing as well?
I was the heavyweight boxing champion of the Pacific Fleet, and all of the, actually, all of the Pacific Fleet, and I was runner-up for the old Navy heavyweight championship. That was in 69.
How old are you?
I'm 51 now. And I started this thing. I started actually with Knievel back in February of 1970 when he jumped at the Cow Palace in San Francisco. My dad was Prescott Sullivan, a sports columnist for the Examiner for over 50 years. He had his own column, and Knievel came into town. And so my dad did an interview, and I went with him. He got his interview, and this, of course, for through the Lord, I stayed and got drunk with Knievel, and he hired me, and I helped him with the Cow Palace show. And at that particular show, the Hell's Angels were there. And the announcer announced that if Knievel made the jump, that he'd set the Hell's Angels back 100 years, which he never should have said that. Because they came out onto the floor after his jump. They threw something at him, a wrench, as he was going up the ramp, and they missed him. And he came back around. They came out on the floor, and we got into it.
It's kind of like a drunken brawl.
It was. And I defended him. And the crowd ended up coming out of their seats and going after the Hell's Angels. It was, it made national news. It was a big deal. And George Hamilton was there shooting, starting to do the preliminaries on the first Evel Knievel movie. And so I ended up as Evel's bodyguard, and because of the event, he took me full time on the road as his first bodyguard. So that's how I started into the stunt business.
So it's kind of unexpected, you just hanging out, and then he asked you.
Yeah, well, I just went to the interview, and I liked him, he liked me, because I'd been a heavyweight boxer, I tried out with the 49ers and the Raiders. I had like a 19-inch neck, I was benching over 400 pounds in weights, I was just bulked out, And I was a bouncer at that time. Private nightclubs in San Francisco, and I was a private bodyguard for some of the private parties that they did. So I mean, that was right in my realm.
I don't know. You had mentioned in one of the tapes that your mother was
B-25. She flew B-25s, and during the war with the WASPs, the Women's Air Corps Auxiliary Service. About 1,200 ladies that did that. And they towed targets for the Army, they ferried airplanes, they transported airplanes. She ended up flying for General Devine in the Aleutian chain during the war. She was his private command pilot. And then after she got out of the military, she met my dad during that time. And then after she got out, she started real estate business, and she ended up drinking herself out of business. She had a real problem with alcohol. And then she ended up in Colorado with a woman partner that she had known in the Army. And they started a crop dusting business, and they did that for 30-some years. They were crop dusters. We owned an airport. That's how I grew up in Colorado.
And then your father, Prescott, so he's a well-known.
Well-known, right. He's dead now, but I mean, he was well-known. I mean, when he died, all the major magazines of Time, Newsweek, all of that stuff.
So what was that like, growing up? Your father's this
well,
and your mother's this.
It was
way ahead of her time.
Oh yeah, way ahead of her time. And matter of fact, my mother and her partner are both inducted in the Aviation Hall of Fame in Colorado. It was confusing, a little bit confusing at times. But we were young. I never really remember living with my mother and my father, maybe one time, because they just didn't get along. He was career. I mean, this guy rode his own collar for 50 years. She was into everything. So, I mean, it was really a difficult relationship. And actually, my grandmother came in the middle of the night and kidnapped my brother and I. This was before social services had their thing and any of that. And she just came and got us. And we didn't see our mother for 3 years, from when I was 6 to 9. And then then my mother got it back in her good graces and said, why don't you send the kids to Colorado for the summertime? Well, she did, and then my mom kept us. So we ended up, you know, in Rifle, Colorado, a cow town, growing up with the crop dusting business and the airport.
So just you and your brother?
Just two brothers. He's a colonel in the Army. He's a Green Beret. He's in the Pentagon right now. It's kind of a joke in the family. He's the successful one. I'm the renegade, you know. He's a year and a half older than I am.
Oh.
I'm the preacher, and I've really gone through it with my mom, because my mom's always been a drinker, fighter, flyer, hunter, you know, and that's how I grew up. That's how I was. And then in 1972, when Jesus got a hold of me, it changed a lot of what I was into. Changed. I gave up Hollywood. I had 2 contracts for 2 movies. I had the richest stunt tour in the world. They fired Evel Knievel and they hired me for a 2-year contract in 5 major cities. It was the richest contract ever. That was with American Motorcycle Schools out of Chicago, a guy named Kenny Brown. This is the guy that invented the Electra Cycle Repair Center. The electronic diagnostic machine that does, I mean, he was ahead of his time, he's a genius. He developed that. And he's a multimillionaire, and through knowing me as Evel's bodyguard and everything, I mean, he saw that I was a marketable commodity, because I really I was a different type than Evel Knievel was. I mean,
what are the differences?
Well, you know, he made a lot of money and became very famous, and he was very arrogant, and everybody owed Evel Knievel. I mean, Evel Knievel was the only one of his kind. I mean, when he started, I mean, he created a whole thing, a whole sports thing. And then when I came along and others came along like me, you know, Evel Knievel he fathered the work, but he became very hard to work with. And I don't know if you remember, but back at that time was about the same time that he beat that guy with a ball bat, the motor broke up on him, and Mattel dropped his toy line. And I mean, and that was really his downfall.
He was too crazy for him.
He was too crazy, and in one sense, he was promoting family, youth, kids, everything, which I believe he had a heart for that, but his lifestyle was so contrary, he had no morals. His lifestyle was so contrary to what he was promoting. It was a joke. And where me, on the other hand, I was athletic, I had a good sports background, I was a little bit ahead of my time too, because back in those days you didn't have the Stallones and the Seagals and the, you know, all of these. You didn't have action movies like, or action heroes like you did now, like you have now. But
the skinny boy.
Yeah, and I was kind of the athletic cowboy yet refined showman, and so that was marketable. But then the Lord got a hold of me, and I just canceled my life.
So what made you just give up all of that? I know it, some of the things you were telling me and the videos, you had the perfect life,
you
had wine. What did you say?
Yeah, wine, women, and song.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah.
That's
all
true.
These things.
But in the scripture, it talks about. It has Jesus encountering several people from the Gospels. Well, my experience was very similar to several of those encounters. My encounter was kind of like St. Paul on the road to Damascus. coming into money. I was coming into fame. I wasn't married. I had no responsibilities. I was 23, 24 years old. I had virtually risked my life several times to make a statement in the entertainment business and in the stunt realm to get where I was at. I was ranked among the five top motorcycle stunt people in the world back in those days, in the early 70s. And so I had five visions, you know, and I had all kinds of activity for where I was going in the world, all kinds of opportunities coming my way. But being raised a Catholic, I did have the knowledge of the Lord in my soul. But, you know, I was the kind of guy that really didn't consider that I did anything bad, though I was a big guy and a bouncer. I wasn't a mean guy. I looked like the Hulk. I mean, my traps went up to almost the bottom of my ears. I mean, I looked, you know, pretty threatening, but I really wasn't. I was very probably. Very calm. Hey, if that's the motorcycle, CC, if that's Jeff, honey, make sure you call Russ and get him over here. But I wasn't mean, and I wasn't, you know, I always cared for people. And maybe in the business to a flaw. Because if it came down to stepping on somebody to get somewhere, I wouldn't do it. If it came down to, you know, disadvantaging somebody else for my advantage, I wouldn't do it. I just didn't feel like, you know, anything was worth it.
You were pretty happy at the time. You weren't happy with your life.
Totally thrilled to death with my life. I mean, life was a bowl of cherries to me. But I went to a meeting. I just went to this Christian breakfast with this girlfriend of mine because she asked me to go.
Did you try to impress her or something?
No, I just, you know, I was a nice guy. I mean, she wanted me to go, and I didn't want to disappoint her, so I just went. And I heard a testimony. First time I ever heard a testimony about the Lord ever speaking to anybody or encountering anybody. And I sat there that morning. And for the first time in my life, I heard that Jesus was really personally interested in individuals and that he had a plan for their life. And sometime during the meeting, I remember just kind of checking out. It was a very small meeting, you know. I mean, I stuck out like a sore thumb because it was just, you know, everybody there was Christian except me. And I had hair down to here, so I mean, you know,
not really hippie,
but kind of like a little shorter than Hulk.
Oh.
I mean, I kind of was hulked out and just kind of, you know, beefed up. Just kind of, I looked the part. I looked back in those days, you know, guys were starting to get their hair a little long in athletics and stuff. And, you know, it was just kind of an intimidating look. You know. So, but of course, I didn't see myself. I really didn't. But I looked a lot different than everybody there. But at some point during the meeting, I checked out. I mean, I just started saying to myself, I said, Lord, I wish you'd speak to me. I mean, you spoke to that man. I wish you'd speak to me.
What was this person?
He was a little guy. Yeah, he was on drugs and he was on heroin. He'd been on heroin for several years and on the needle. One night, this was his testimony. One night, he woke up out of a sound sleep, sat up in bed, and the Lord said to him, throw away your heroin, I'll heal you. And he went to the bathroom, threw away his heroin, and the next morning he woke up delivered. I mean, he never went through withdrawals, anything. And what got me about that was not the healing. What got me about that is Jesus spoke to him, not audibly, but in his heart, enough to, you know, wake the guy up. Man, when I heard that, I said, Jesus, I wish you'd speak to me. And he did that morning. And I'm telling you, if the Lord ever speaks to you, you'll know it. It absolutely.
It's like his voice, you hear his voice.
In my spirit, in my spirit, the Lord started showing me what a jerk I was. He started showing me who I was. This, I'll clean up my act a little here, but I mean, what a real jerk I was. What an ass I was. I mean, really. Not because I was going around hurting people, just because of the whole industry I was in, the whole thing about me, you know, and my actually my carousing with women. I never saw what that did to them. You know, it was always if it's okay with them, it's okay with me, there's no problem. I never really saw what it did to a girl's life to get involved in all of that before marriage. And it's like in 40 minutes, I'm going through my life. I mean, I'm going through all this revelation about these things I'm doing that are just, that are counterproductive to love and good and selfishness. And I'll be honest with you, the main speaker came up. It was a guy named Albie Pearson, who used to be a famous baseball player. Albie Pearson played for the Angels, and he was called the Littlest Angel. And he was the main speaker. I didn't remember anything this guy said, because during his message, I was being dealt with by the Spirit of God. And then the next thing I remember, and this may sound funny, but I mean, this is the way it happened. The next thing I remember is the altar call. I was a Catholic. I'd never been to an altar call. I never knew what it was. And they said, if the Lord's talking to you, you come forward. Well, I knew the Lord was talking to me, so I got up and I went forward. And I sat down. They had this big old sofa chair on this stage. It was an auditorium. It was in Truckee, Nevada. It was in this armory there. And they had this old sofa chair. And they sat me down in the sofa chair. Four men laid hands on me, and they began to lead me through a prayer. I had the most dynamic encounter with the Spirit of God to this day. I've never experienced what I experienced that day. If you read the Gospels, you'll see that Jesus puts people through deliverance, their spirits come off. That happened to me. I mean, I never read the Bible, never been taught the Bible. Demons came off of me. I mean, it was a 20-minute God run down. But when I got out of that chair, I was going, wow. It was really like, you know, the song that says, once I was blind, now I see, scales fell off my eyes. That's really what happened. And my life never, from that hour, never has been the same. And I ended up canceling my life, walking away from
it. So what all these people think
they thought I was nuts. They thought I was nuts. Honestly, they thought something happened. And something did. It wasn't bad. And it wasn't. I wasn't really nuts. But I mean, my mom, she sat me down. She said, there's money for you for psychiatric help. I mean, she was serious. She was dead serious. And all I can say is, well, I don't know what to tell you. I said, I just pray it happens to you so you'll know. My manager, this Kenny Brown out of Chicago, the guy was a Jew, and I didn't know this, but he was Jewish. And when I called him up, and I'd already signed a 2-year contract with this guy, they owned me. And they started publicity already on 5 major cities. These guys could have sued me. I mean, I had 3 brand new motorcycles coming from them. All my expenses were paid. I was guaranteed a minimum of $20,000 to $30,000 a performance. I mean, this was the heyday. That this is what everybody in the business, you know, back in those days. This is back in 1972, and
dolls made
across the room. Oh yeah, I mean, this was, and I had 2 movie opportunities with and a Sears contract for commercials. I mean. boom, I was ready to walk right into fame, which was really what I was after. That's what I was after. I didn't care about the money. I wanted to go in the movies. I wanted to be somebody. And so that's what the Lord went after. He said, he basically said, Gene, I want you to follow me into the ministry. And to do that, you've got to give up all this other stuff. It's your choice.
So what did Kenny tell you?
Kenny Brown. I didn't know what the guy was going to do, and I prayed 2 weeks before I called him.
Why did you tell him?
You know, I didn't know what I was going to tell him. And I prayed about it for 2 weeks, and then I figured, well, I got to do this. So I called him up. I said, Kenny, now, one thing, when I went up and signed the contract, I brought a Bible with me. When I signed the contract, I'd already become a Christian before that, but the Lord hadn't spoken to me to walk away from it. So he knew I was a Christian. He knew I carried a Bible, but, you know, that was cool. So I called him up and I said, Kenny, I don't know how to tell you this. I'm going to just tell you how it happened. Jesus spoke to me. Death over the phone. He says, he spoke to you? What are you talking about? I said, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me in my spirit. What did he say? I said, told me to walk away from all this, Kenny. And I said, I don't know how to tell you this. I don't know how to put it to you. But I said, you told me to walk away from all this. And I said, I got to cancel this. I got to cancel my life. The Lord's got another direction for me to go. And just silence over the phone, and he said the most remarkable thing. He said, this guy has had, I don't even know if he's alive for it. Got in a major car accident a little time after this. He said, maybe someday the Lord will speak to me. And he just hung up.
He
didn't sue me. My life in the entertainment business was over. It was that quick.
So how did this whole jump for Jesus, how did you know that that was what
you were supposed to do? And you know what I did? I had a garbage sack. I had a 30-gallon garbage sack that I, all my pictures, a manuscript for a book a guy was writing on me, put it all in a garbage sack, threw it out. 30-gallon garbage sack full of material and pictures that if I had it today, I could get that to a publisher. Pictures, unbelievable stuff. Thing, I jumped through plate glass windows, real plate glass windows, in a t-shirt. I did this in front of the news in San Francisco during rush hour traffic on one of the busiest streets in San Francisco. Made all of the news. It was a wild, crazy thing I did. But all that stuff, I bundled it all up and I threw it away because I figured my life was over and I had to start all over again.
Just real briefly before we go on, what are some of the other things you did? You jumped the glass windows, you said you risked your life.
Oh yeah, there's a little picture in that green one. I jumped a bike off of a 17 and a half foot high ramp at almost 70 miles an hour into a lake.
You jumped into a lake
with a motorcycle I designed with water skis to water ski to an island 200 yards in the middle of the lake. I jumped. It was a world record jump at that time. I almost jumped 200 feet with this motorcycle. And the thing crashed. I mean, I didn't get hurt, thank goodness, but stupid things. Wheelies. I had films that I threw away of me wheeling behind the Hyde Street trolley going up Hyde Street in San Francisco, freaking tourist out. Wheeling all the way up Hyde Street. Wheeling, yeah. Wheeling all the way up California Street, running red lights. I mean, the things that I used to do just to put it on tape and build a file was just, you know, not smart back in those days. And I never wore a helmet. I wear jeans, a t-shirt, cowboy boots, and that was it. And I could really... The jumps I wore helmets, but for my wheelie shows and all that, I never used to wear. And all of it was to get somewhere, of course.
So this lake, what lake was that?
Orgyle Park out of Sacramento, California. I got a little picture of that portfolio, that little portfolio.
Is that the Denny's crash?
That's the craziest thing I've ever seen.
Did you have broken bones?
No, I didn't even get hurt.
Never had broken bones?
I broke my hand once in Iowa. Broke it out doing some practice release. Then I did three programs with a broken hand. Then after the programs were over, I got cast.
How about when you're doing your jump for Jesus? How many cars? What's the whole routine?
The routine is anywhere. It depends on the space. You see, jump for Jesus, this is why we're so unique, is that I'll go anywhere. My son Wade now, who's going to be 20, he's jumping also. But we go anywhere. We jump in parks, main streets, rodeo grounds, you name it. We're mostly
cars jumping over cars.
Cars, trucks, you know, in South Florida, alligators. I mean, I've jumped over a bunch of stuff.
Alligators?
Yeah, you know, a whole bunch of stuff. On the Indian reservation for the Seminole Indians. Had the animal rights activists after us for that one. But where we're gearing for now is the South Pacific, because last year we did the King's 79th birthday. We did five programs in Tonga, and last year, and then this year we went to the Crown Prince's birthday and did two programs for him on Babao, another island in Tonga.
What's the most cars you've done? So you've done alligators, you've done how many cars?
My longest jump is about 18 cars, but it wasn't. There weren't
before,
18.
Before the jump for Jesus?
That was during the jump for Jesus. Because I've traveled all over Canada, the United States, doing this, but our bread and butter jump is 10 to 15 cars through the burning wall. And see, we're not doing it for distance. We're not there to break records. We're there to deliver a message and give a picture of the gates of hell, which is the wall, the message, the valley that separates from the time we begin in life to the time we end in life. There's a whole message that goes with it. And so the program is designed for delivering the gospel and also praying for the sick and opening the
altar. You wear that and any other protection? That's the only protection?
This is it. This is it.
And a helmet.
And
what kind of wood is it?
It's a 3/4 inch insulation board. Called insulation. And it's a, you don't have it here in Hawaii because they don't use it, but it's a four, it comes with 4 inches.
And you douse it with how much gallons?
We throw about 2 gallons of gas in it.
So it's still.
Is it set up down there?
It's set up.
Go do it now, and we'll walk down.
And then we can continue.
Sure. They need probably about 5 minutes.
Okay. Have you ever hurt yourself during the journey?
I have.
Or your son?
No. I've fallen off the bike a considerable amount of times. It's just the nature of the business, because you put yourself in harm's way when you get on a motorcycle. I mean, anybody who rides a bike knows that, and especially if you do any kind of performance riding like motocross or trail riding or anything like that. But nobody that's ever rode a motorcycle for any time at all hasn't probably fallen off of it. But when you do stunts, of course, it's a whole other ball game. But no, I've never been seriously hurt, and neither have my son. I've been burned a little bit. matter of fact, you can see this.
Where it caught on fire and stayed on fire.
In Tonga, the jump I did in Tonga, the jump I did in Tonga was so short. This is another one of the problems we encountered, but this is one of the reasons why we do what we do is we will go anywhere. And we went to just a soccer field on this island in the Kingdom of Tonga. 4,000 people showed up. We did a jump there. We built down ramps, we built platforms, we built to suit the jump so we can do a decent jump safely. But about 11,000 people came to the last show that I did for the King, and there were no barricades. I mean, it was wall-to-wall people. I was really concerned. And so I shortened the jump up from 10 cars to 8 cars. And after I made the jump, a piece of the firewall stuck to me, big piece stuck to me. And I couldn't throw it off because the crowd had closed in, and I had a very short place to stop, so I had to get the bike stopped. If I hadn't stopped, I'd have gone right into the crowd. They shut the entrance. They shut the gate. People became the gate. So I had to get it shut down. I got the bike shut down before I got the piece off me, and it stayed on me too long. And it burned through it. Of course, once the leather gets hot, continues to burn when you throw it off, but I didn't get burned bad. It's just, and I've had the fire come underneath my helmet before, jumping into the wind, and I got all my eyebrows, my whiskers, everything got singed. And since then, I bought a fire retardant helmet, so the flame couldn't go up into my mask. I mean, some of these things I've had to learn by trial and error, unfortunately. We could probably, I'll get my shoes on.
Okay.
Socks. Unmade.
Do you have like an envelope that I can, I'm going to give this to Ronan to take to the office?
I do, and I found that other picture too.
Oh, you did? Yeah. Oh my gosh, that's incredible. My editors will just...
Which one?
Keep jumping
through the door. Which one?
Where is it?
I got stuff all over here. You want to grab those for
me? Oh!
Sorry, my hands are all dirty.
You said yours.
I don't know if you can use, see the playhead? Is that something she might need?
No, she won't be able to use
it. Actually, they...
Black and white.
And
oh, that one is black and white.
I'm going to pause this to get my shoes on. We're going downstairs outside to the bike.
Where's the picture, Cece?
People in the area over there, so they were looking at a couple other places, and he went down there to help them pick out a place. Ronan.
Need to go this way.
Yeah. What about a shot in through here like this? Is that still bad?
Shooting.
How about you out with the helmet? Yeah. So maybe this way. If I shoot in to this area, I think we hit the sign. It's like
okay. How about if we shoot toward the tree?
Is it better?
Let's let him stand.
Okay.
This be all right? The same here or not? Sandy's Honda.
Oh, let's go.
What's the guy's name, honey?
Sandy Brody.
Sandy Brody.
Yeah, we thought maybe if we advertise for him, he'll give us a motorcycle and a helmet.
Great.
Get
him,
don't get me. Okay. Get over there, Russ, and get the whole thing.
Fall
down the hill.
Yeah, I do my best.